Okay, folks, welcome to another evening of lively debate. I'm your moderator, Marko Balogh. I'm the president of the PSU Freethinker. Tonight's debate topic will be which best explains man's origin, creation, or evolution. And for the creation side, we have Dr. Bart Rask, and for the evolution side, we have Bernie Dehler. We'll begin with 20-minute presentations by each speaker, followed by a 10-minute interrogation in which they'll be able to converse, but one speaker will have the right to interrupt the other, followed by 28 minutes of conversation with the audience. So we're going to try to have it, rather than cutting people off while they're talking to the speakers, we're going to allow some more open conversation. And then we'll close with short summaries by each speaker. So Bernie, you have the first 20 minutes when you're ready.
Okay, yeah, I'm ready. All right, so you can see the slide over here on the wall. And okay, good, I can see the timer there. So just a little bit of a background about me. I grew up as a Roman Catholic through high school. In college, I became a born-again evangelical Christian. I was one for over 25 years. I liked apologetics and evangelism, and so through those 25 years, I grew as an evangelical Christian. I even started a ministry called freegoodnews.com where I could preach the gospel on cable TV, local cable TV, and the internet. While I was working in the computer field, I got a master's degree from Lutherized Seminary. It's a conservative Baptist seminary, young earth creationist viewpoint. And I became an atheist in 2009, 2 years after I got my seminary degree, which is 5 years ago now. I'm active in atheist and secular leadership in the local area. For example, I started a group called the Center for Philosophical Naturalism to help promote a naturalistic worldview. And also involved in Sunday Assembly. I'm the chairman of the local Sunday Assembly group. And it's known as the church without the God bits kind of thing. So they have like popular songs and inspirational messages without God. That's what Sunday Assembly is, in case you haven't heard of it. And then I'm also involved in prison outreach. I'm meeting with an inmate at the federal prison in Sheridan, Oregon, to help them get a humanist group started there. So here's two major hypotheses we want to talk about. And some people may think there's more than just two. Let's not have a false dichotomy here. But I think we could say there's two if we look at it, especially from just the human origins standpoint. One major hypothesis is that humans descended from other animals, and whether that's God-guided or not, let's just talk about common descent. Did humans descend from other animals, or was it basically a work of magic? You know, God did something from scratch, whether it's literal in the Bible where he molded clay into the form of a human, a man, and breathed life into it, or some other poof kind of thing. So basically, there's creation by poof is one major way. This is what the young earth creationists and the old earth creationists believe, is that God just did these miracles from scratch at certain points in time. And the evolution says that humans evolved from other animals. So even if you say it was God-guided, I think that's a big development in the Christian community, because I think like 40% of the population in America right now rejects common descent. And if there is a Christian that does, I have different arguments for people. I want to take them even further into atheism, if I can even get them this far. So usually my chore is just even trying to get people to get common descent. So anyway, those are the two big pictures, two major hypotheses. Humans evolved from other animals, from descent, or from a miracle. So how can we evaluate different hypotheses? You know, maybe there's more hypotheses. Like, for example, intelligent design said maybe an alien did it. Well, if an alien did it and they did not evolve from common descent, that's kind of a special creation moment too. So again, that's anti-evolution, because evolution says animals evolved from other animals. Okay, so this is a really good book. I always meant this is kind of like my Bible. This is taught in critical thinking courses in philosophy. How to think about weird things, because really all the interesting things are weird, like UFOs, the abominable snowman, Loch Ness Monster, spontaneous human combustion, even creation and evolution debates or creationism. They talk about all of it in here. And so when you have, you know, one of the things is when you're trying to figure out what's the reality here, you want to figure out what all your different hypotheses are and then try to figure out some way to judge these. Which one is the best hypothesis? And so it says there's a criteria of adequacy these two authors talk about. And you probably never heard of these authors. They're philosophy professors. But so anyway, this criteria of adequacy is five things. One is testability, then fruitfulness, scope, simplicity, and conservatism. So just briefly, testability means your hypothesis is testable. They mentioned that if your hypothesis is not testable, it's worthless. It's not that it could be, it could still be true or false, but it's just worthless because you can't test it. So usually testability is a really big thing with science and hypothesis testing to see which is a better hypothesis. If you have two hypotheses, one you can test and one you can't, the one that you can test has a lot more weight going for it, or a lot more power behind it. Another one is fruitfulness. Can your hypothesis bring more knowledge that we haven't learned before? And so like, for example, with evolution, there are certain things you might predict, like where to find a fossil, and they actually dig there and find those fossils according to evolution, which if you had the alternate hypothesis, you would have no reason to dig there, for example. So fruitfulness is, does it bring more additional information? Another one is scope. Does your hypothesis explain a whole bunch of things, or is it just one thing? For example, in evolution, does it explain maybe, does it work in conjunction? For example, there's different fossils around different areas based on where these animals lived. So do you take that into account, or do you just look at one little area and say like, oh, well, we're just looking at rabbits in this one area here. And you have a hypothesis that would not stack up somewhere else. So scope is, does it touch other areas? Very good. And simplicity is, does it make sure that your hypothesis doesn't unnecessarily create unnecessary, this is called Occam's razor, where unnecessary ideas to support it. So for example, if you said these fluorescent bulbs work by invisible demons that you cannot test, well, the invention of invisible demons and other things are other things you're creating to try to explain something. So if somebody else just has an explanation about maybe it works with gases that are energized with electrical fields, that doesn't create a bunch of unknown things. So usually the simpler, the better it is. Because the more you add on, the more likely you are to go astray on a certain theory. And then the conservatism is, does it align with all the other facts you know of the world? So for example, with evolution, there's other things such as the age of the universe and the age of the earth. Does your theory align with these other fields, like cosmology, that do they all fit together, or is it just not thinking about that and like assuming a young earth because that makes your theory good? And if you had to consider the other things like the age of the earth, according to science, it would probably blow your theory away. So conservatism is, does your theory work good with all the background knowledge that we have in science? Okay, so some of the claims of ideas that are statistically improbable, life is too wonderfully complex, there's a fine-tuning argument called the anthropic principle, that life was just, these parameters are just right to make life as we know it for humans. And then I want to just throw out some things to consider, like what is life and what is death. Now, what I'm going to do here is, what I should really do is talk about these two different hypotheses and rate them according to this. But what I want to do, actually, I'm going to talk more about, I want to try to widen your viewpoint with some different facts. And so it's kind of, I'm kind of going on that last one, conservatism. I want to show you some things that you may not know. So if you believe in creationism, you have to square it with these other facts. Because if you're not, if you don't know about these other facts, then you don't have any problems because there's no conflict. But once you understand, the more science you know, the more conflicts you can have. And the, you know, actually, the more sure you can be about your hypothesis because it's aligning with all the background information. So I want to bring some things that people don't usually know about. So one of the claims with ideas that, and this is from the Discovery Institute, this is actually, you know, a quote, cut and paste. They said, high-speed computers, supercomputers have now used large-scale number crunching to calculate the eons of time and probabilities that are required to develop a cell through chance and mutation. As if they know, I mean, hey, this is accurate. I mean, supercomputers are doing this. But the way the probabilities are is, you cannot have an accurate, nobody can calculate the probability of an unknown process is what it comes down to. If I had a deck of cards here and I said, what are the odds of getting an ace of hearts out of here? You might say one out of 52. But what if I didn't tell you what this deck is? Maybe they're all ace of hearts. The probability is 100% if so. Or what if I remove the ace of hearts? The probability is zero. Or what if I removed all the red cards? You know, you just cannot predict something without knowing the underlying processes. And nobody knows how, in detail, how life arose from non-life. Therefore, you cannot calculate it. So it doesn't matter if you have supercomputers or not. You can crunch all the numbers you want to, but if you don't know the process, you can't calculate it. So that might be a form of gambling logical fallacy. Another one is, you know, the cell is so mind-boggling, it's got to be made. I mean, it's just, at Darwin's time, they thought the cell was like jello, you know, just something really simple. But the more you get in there, you see all these micro machines and everything. And I want to totally agree with this. It is mind-blowing. And, you know, and the same thing with physics. It's mind-blowing when you look at subatomic particles. And, you know, I think the key here is that we are dumb creatures still. I mean, the creationists are saying, we are so smart, if we can't figure it out, obviously it's a miracle. But to show you how silly that is, that'd be like Neanderthals around the fire saying, hey, nobody can figure out how thunder is made, therefore it must be God. But, you know, now we know it's electrical differences. We don't know how earthquakes are made, therefore it must be God. No, they were dumb Neanderthals. They didn't know anything about that. Now we know. And in the same way, we're just kind of coming up to speed as animals from nature trying to figure out what's going on here. So yeah, it is. It blows us away about how complicated it is. But that's no reason to say, oh, it was therefore the answer is magic because we can't explain it. That's basically what idea is in a nutshell. There's a cartoon where a scientist writes down some equations, and then he has a block that says a miracle happens, and then more equations, and his fellow professor says, I think you should have more details in this second step here about where the miracle happens. So, you know, just to let you know what we don't know, I mean, Einstein, there's a thing called quantum entanglement where you can get two photons entangled, and when you modify one, the other one's modified. Even if you can separate these across the universe, when you move one, the other one moves. Even though light can't even travel that far because the universe is expanding, light can't even traverse it because it's expanding faster than light, but it's instantaneously moved. When you move one, you move the other one. Einstein didn't like that idea. He called it spooky action at a distance. This just shows you, I'll talk more about this too, but it shows you about what we don't know. There's so much we don't know about this. There's one here. Okay, well, for example, another argument for about fine-tuning, they have like 20 things about why the universe is so finely tuned that it could not have come by a mindless nature. One is about the explosion of the Big Bang, and that if it was any different, you know, things wouldn't have worked out. Here's a, Victor Stenger is a physicist who wrote a book about this, and basically his summary was, in short, much of the so-called fine-tuning of the parameters of microphysics is in the eye of the beholder, not always sufficiently versed in physics, who plays with the numbers until they seem to support a prior belief that was based on something other than objective scientific analysis. So in other words, a person believes in God's magic, and he says, look at these parameters to support all this. He also said that, you know, there are like maybe four parameters that might be finely tuned, and a lot of the other ones don't, they're not really fine-tuning things. Like, for example, the speed of light, that's just a measurement. It's not really anything finely tuned. So there's a whole list of things about this fine-tuning argument. But in the end, I'm going to get back to this, that there's so much we don't know, and basically you shouldn't just jump to, we don't know, therefore it's magic. For example, on this last bullet here, according to the Planck mission team, in the standard model of cosmology, the total mass energy of the known universe contains 4.9% ordinary matter, 26, almost 27% dark matter, and 68% dark energy. Dark matter and dark energy is a total unknown. So we have 5% here that we kind of understand, and 75%, they're clueless. They don't know what dark matter is and dark energy. It's kind of placeholders in their equations. Michio Kaku, too, is another person. When it came to this quantum entanglement, He mentioned how physicists have no idea how this quantum entanglement works, how it's connected, because it's, like I said, even the speed of light cannot react that fast, and nothing can go faster than the speed of light. And he said, this is embarrassing the physicists. It's like we don't know anything. They don't even understand. It's like we don't know the fabric of reality here. Just to, I think, humble everybody a little bit. So one question is, what is life and what is death? So on life, you know, you kind of think, well, it's obvious, you know, things are alive or they're dead. But then you think of something like a virus. Is a virus alive? Look at this virus in the picture. It looks like a spaceship. It lands on the cell and it injects DNA. It cannot reproduce its own DNA. It injects DNA into a cell. The cell replicates it, and then these replicated viruses pop out of the cell. And this is how they replicate. Now, if you think this is an intelligent design too, I mean, it's kind of cool, the spaceship virus here, the way it works. Is this God's intelligent design, this virus? I mean, did he intelligent design this to do all these diseases too, like HIV and AIDS? Is God designing these things? I mean, sometimes people just give intelligent design for the good things. What about the evil things or the bad things, all the pain and misery it's doing? So look at the entire picture there, not just look at the good things only. And then for death, did you know that tree frogs can be frozen, totally frozen? There's no heartbeat. There's no brain waves. There's nothing. They're totally frozen. And then when the spring comes, their heart starts beating again. You can go on YouTube and watch this. You can see a frozen frog sort of come back to life, quote. But, it, you know, is it even coming back to life? What is this death? Because when it's frozen, and let's say you smashed it, it's not any more dead than it was. It's in the same state of not operating. So is that dead? And then if you say, yeah, it's dead, well, then how would it come back to life? How do you come back to life from the dead? So life and death are very complicated, and there's various, you know, and so like when you say, like, how did life arise? It could very well arise in stages through a lot of different increments. And this is why it's really tricky to think about what is life, because like I said earlier, is a virus alive? You know, you might say, well, life basically has to be, you know, has to be able to reproduce. Well, a virus can't reproduce by itself, but it has DNA. You know, as far as intelligent designs, like, these things are so amazing. It must be intelligent designed. What about unintelligent design? For example, vitamin C. We have to eat vitamin C because our body cannot make it. Why can't our body make it? Because we have a busted enzyme. It's called the Gulo gene for short. If we don't eat vitamin C, we get scurvy. The chimps, our cousins, have the same problem, and gorillas too. But you know, a lot of other mammals don't, like dogs, cats, and mice. They don't have that problem. They don't have to eat vitamin C. Their body makes it. So why do we have this corrupted copy and the chimps, but not the cats and the lions? You know, sometimes Christians say, like, oh, it was part of the fall. Okay, so why would God mess up our vitamin C gene in our human body, and also for the chimp, but not the cats? You know, the dividing line didn't make sense there. So there's a whole bunch of pseudogenes. I'll talk more about some of those. Pseudogenes are busted copies of genes that we have inherited. So they don't make any sense with intelligent design if you think that God made us from scratch. But it all makes sense if you believe that there was common descent. How about evil design? Mark Twain said that, you know, if a human were to invent the fly and set this thing loose in Africa or something, this guy would be worse than Hitler. The flies are so good at transmitting disease, both bacteria and viruses. And, you know, this is said to be made by an all-loving and all-knowing God. So this is kind of hard to square when you talk about intelligent design. And then look at all the different funny things in nature. Is God really making funny things like this? I mean, with evolution, it makes sense that nature is trying to find all these ecological niches and fill them. You know, like the platypus, a mammal that lays eggs. That's a very rare thing. Has the bill of a duck. A duck is a bird, not a mammal. The tail of a beaver, and it's even venomous. Usually, it's the reptiles and the fish that are venomous. It's very rare for a mammal. The male platypus has a spur on its hind limb that can inject venom. And then sometimes people think, well, you know, sex is so amazing because you got male and female, and how could that arise? How could you explain that? Mm-hmm. You know, flatworms are kind of funny. I mean, there's a whole bunch of funny things going on in sex in the animal world, but just one thing is these flatworms, they have these dagger-like penises and they basically fence, and the one that gets stabbed is the one that becomes the mother. So that's an interesting way. But there's a whole bunch of hermaphrodism in there, which means they have both male and female reproductive organs. There's a bunch of animals like that. Like all sea slugs are hermaphrodites. I found that accepting evolution is kind of a watershed event. That's why I like to focus on human evolution, because once you accept this, then all other ones, all other objections seem to fall away. I have two evidences here I want to talk about, which I'm going to run out of time for, but one is fused human chromosome number 2. We see vestigial telomeres and centromeres. If you want to talk about this, we could talk about this. And the other one, this is a chart about the pseudogenes. For example, the one at the very bottom there shows that everybody, the orangutan, gorilla, chimp, and human, have this one broken pseudogene. The next three means just the gorilla and the chimp and the human have that, but not the orangutan. The next three means that the gorilla, the chimp, and the human have that, but not the, I mean, the chimp and the human have that, but not the gorilla or the orangutan. And then the human has 15, but these, you know, the chimp and the gorilla and the orangutan don't have these. So basically, you can see how it falls through descent. This is a Christian that accepts evolution said this is what changed his mind. So basically, I just want to say in summary that all I can offer you, here's an inspirational thing. Basically, if you leave Christianity, you accept the world as it is, you don't have to wonder about why bad things happen. That's just nature. And there's no replacement for, you know, Santa Claus and free gifts. It's just you got to deal with your mortality. But I think you appreciate life more because you're accepting it as it is. So I'll leave it with that.
Okay, thank you, Bernie. Dr. Rask, you have 20 minutes for your presentation.
All right. My name is Bart Rask. My day job is I'm an orthopedic surgeon in private practice in Hillsboro. And instead of golf, I do these debates with Bernie.
Time's up.
All right. So I'm going to give the my version of the Christian point of view. I also, my bachelor's degree is in microbiology. I authored several papers and had them published in orthopedic surgery journals, wrote 3 chapters in orthopedic surgery. The hat I'm wearing is of that one of the principal reviewer of the American Journal of Sports Medicine. This is the most widely read orthopedic journal in the world, and I've been a principal reviewer for several years now. My role as a reviewer is to see if conclusions written by investigators match the data, and that is what I did with the theory of evolution. I published this book in which I looked really over 500 references. And it's the only science-based peer-reviewed evolution critique. And it contains point-by-point challenges to my critique by evolutionists from UCal Berkeley and another one from Oregon State. When I was writing this book, someone told me, well, how would someone challenge your remarks? And so I paid 2 very experienced fellows to challenge my remarks. And I said, you have to support your challenge with references. So they sent me their references, and I read their references, and all their points were just variations of a theme that didn't change my opinion. Creationism, universe, life, natural law created by a supernatural force of God, while natural law explains how life works. Creationism, the supernatural, explains how life began. A lot of people conflate these two issues, how it works versus how it began. Evolution, defined by the National Science Foundation, is descent with modification from common ancestor. The mechanism is sometimes misquoted as simply natural selection. First, you must modify the individual by random mutation of the DNA, then you modify the population by natural selection. Natural selection modifies the population after an individual is changed. There are 2 types of truths theories. There is scientific, which include empirical evidence and testability. such as in medicine, the law of gravity, and their historical truths based on believing that the humans that wrote the records are not lying, such as what we know about the Holocaust, the ancient Roman Empire. Creationism falls into historical truth. It's based on what's written in the book of Genesis as written by Moses, as dictated by God. Cases against creationism. Well, many people just deny the historical record. They claim it was misrecorded, fabricated. But these arguments could be said for any historical phenomenon, like the Holocaust. Now, a good argument is supernatural phenomena have never occurred. I say they have. I don't think that's a very productive argument. It's a he said, she said argument, and I'm not going to focus on this. My case for creationism boils down to this. There's human documentation of creationism. Some people just flatly deny it. Evolution is doesn't advertise to have any human documentation. No one claimed to have seen apes, ape-like creatures evolve to man. So it's not part of the equation. Scientific evidence, creationism, doesn't claim to have scientific evidence. It's based on historical record. Evolution claims to have scientific evidence, but it's really not scientific evidence, and I'll show you why. Creationism can be inferred from observations. Evolution claims it can be inferred, but it really can't. Inferring creationism. Both evolution and creationism assume in the beginning there were no complex organisms, then a phenomenon created complex organisms. Creationism is inferred because of a continuation of the trend of the observed relationship between increasing complexity and increasing intelligence. Evolution cannot be inferred because there is no observed relationship between increasing complexity, random mutation, natural selection, and time, which equals evolution. Now, my basis for creationism, some people call this analogous to the watchmaker's analogy. If the best you can accomplish is chaos, you don't have any intelligence, like a storm. Simple things like nests and hives, you have minimal intelligence, such as in birds and bees. If you're a low-intelligent human, and the best you can do is a mousetrap. Computers, much more complex, require a high-intelligent human. Cells and man, ever more complex, require the highest intelligence. That is how I rationalize creationism. Inferring evolution has no basis. Evolution correlates with variations of the same, not greater, complexity. Bernie and I agree on some features of what I call science, he calls adequacy. We both agree that testability is important. I listed the philosophers, my references. There's William Whewell, Braithwaite, and Popper. Falsifiability and empirical evidence, anything that which can be observed or measured. These are criteria accepted by evolutionists, and I listed four. They're not my criteria. Evolution theory is not science. There's no empirical evidence, and you cannot test a theory that purportedly occurred over billions and millions of years. Now, example of true testability is in microbiology. You can test that Staph aureus causes skin boils by inoculating staph versus saline to the skin. The result is boil caused by the staph only. You cannot test historical truths. These are based on written documents and the fact that you believe the witnesses. The Holocaust is one, history of the Roman Empire, and I acknowledge that you cannot test the existence of God. You cannot, so for example, you cannot do an experiment in 2015 to gather empiric evidence for any of those things. I do believe in microevolution. And microevolution does have empiric evidence, but there are limits to what microevolution can accomplish based on my extensive review of the literature and collaboration with scientists. Microevolution, so, are the empirically documented changes in response to the environment. The limits are, number one, no ability to evolve physiologic reproductive isolation, and no ability to involve increased physiologic complexity. Increased complexity defined, never observed by evolution. Microevolution involves only horizontal changes. That means no change in complexity, which means no increased number of functioning and different parts, such as there's changes in color, shape, size, carbon metabolism, and destruction or modification of proteins. Macroevolution, this is where we disagree, involves vertical changes, increasing complexity, adding new parts which are different and function, such as the nephridium, which is a primitive kidney in a invertebrate, which doesn't have a capsule and has very few nephrotubules, is believed to be the ancestor of the modern kidney, which has a capsule and millions of microtubules. That would be an example of macroevolution, a single-celled creature to a heterogeneous multicellular creature. I say heterogeneous multicellular creature because true multicellular creatures have cells with different functions that have specialization, not just clumps of identical cells. And it's also never been observed that a creature with a 9-protein flagellum can evolve even one more. Defining what physiologic reproductive isolation means. That is what evolution says happened millions of times. So that means two species that cannot reproduce. So if you put a sperm and an egg in a test tube or do artificial insemination, there will be no viable offspring. This contrasts with non-physiologic reproductive isolation, which occurs all the time in microevolution. Two species do not reproduce, but could. You put a sperm, an egg will yield viable offspring if you bypass some barriers, such as behavioral, social, geographic, and genitalia size. Scientific literature does not support the evolution of physiologic reproductive isolation, yet evolution says it's happened millions of times. Physiologic reproductive isolations. Examples. Well, an experiment done by a Soviet biologist actually impregnated human sperm in female chimps. Nothing happened. At Cornell University, there was in vitro fertilization attempt by human sperm with monkeys, baboons, several other mammals in many different permutation computations, and nothing happened. And in fish, do external fixations, so external fertilization. So most fish, they have their sperm and egg floating around exposed to all kinds of sperms and eggs of other species, yet there's no cross-fertilization. So, never observed by evolution. You have an ancestral creature, whether it's an ancestral primate, evolves into two different creatures, chimp and man. We know chimp and man cannot reproduce physiologically. It's been tried. But this phenomenon where you have a population which can reproduce among itself, evolve into two physiologically isolated reproductively, has never been observed. False arguments for evolution. It's argued that it's testable, and that you can test the theory by looking for outcomes of what it predicts, such as what Bernie says about how you can predict that you'll have certain fossils at certain in certain areas. Or, for example, you have evolution predicts pseudogenes. Well, my criticism is that there's no demonstration that evolution ever occurred to produce these outcomes. It's only asserted. No one witnessed random mutation and natural selection producing the fossils. No one witnessed the pseudogenes being produced by random mutation and natural selection. Evolution predicts many outcomes, therefore it must be true. However, a geocentric universe predicts all the locations of the sun. The theory of preformation, which is an old theory where the newly fertilized sperm and egg look like a newborn baby, that would actually accurately predict that every newborn and every animal would also look like a newborn baby. So the number of positive outcomes is not enough to support your theory. You must show the outcome was caused by the theory. So a problem with evolution tests. Evolution is not really tested, since the theory is neither tested nor observed when you simply go out and find things. Real testing involves observing random mutation natural selection producing the outcome. Now, analogously, creation can also be falsely tested, the same as the evolution. Creation predicts complex life mechanisms and an imperfect man. Now, I disagree with that rationale. Example of a real test of a theory is you have you claim that a statin drug lowers your cholesterol. So you give a statin drug versus a placebo, and the outcome is lower cholesterol. Well, evolution claims to cause pseudogenes, but without observing the random mutation natural selection. This would be like claiming a drug lowers cholesterol, but you never observe the drug given. Another false argument, you can infer evolution. Like, what else could it be? It's the simplest explanation. We know by inference. Well, conclusions that can be inferred and simple must be supported by analogous examples. The problem with evolution, there are no analogous examples. So proper inference requires analogous examples. So you can infer an infection after surgery is due to staph without doing any tests, and that happens all the time. And you give an anti-staph drug even though you didn't test for staph in that particular patient. But you know but you can infer it based on thousands of tests done in other patients under similar circumstance. But you cannot support your you're giving an anti-staph drug based on tests from sexually transmitted infections. It's not an analogous example. Another false inference from evolution is since microevolution is observed, you can infer with time macroevolution is observed. Problem, it's not an analogous example. Microevolution and macro are qualitatively different. Micro, you have the same complexity, no physiologic reproductive isolation. Macro, the opposite. True inference, an example of true inference for evolution would be if you actually documented there are 10 species that evolve increased complexity or physiologic reproduction, then you can infer that evolution possibly occurred for all species. That's how you really infer. Would evolution be possible? No, because life requires intermolecular fit, and you can do some calculations. So complexity implies a design or creator. You have a 51 amino acid insulin. It must fit a 731 amino acid alpha receptor, which is in all of your cells, with rare exceptions. That alpha receptor must fit a 620 amino acid beta receptor in order to initiate the insulin reaction. There's intermolecular fit, and you look in any biochemistry book and every page is filled with these types of interactions. So to evolve an insulin receptor, suppose that an ancestral alpha receptor needed to change just 5 amino acids to fit the insulin and the beta receptor. Remember, the alpha receptor is sandwiched between the two. So you have to consider the 4 different nucleotides and the DNA gene size, and you do the math, and you come out to this 1 chance in 5 times 10 to the 19th for just 5 amino acid changes in this extremely large gene. And so the evolving genes for intermolecular fit would be statistically impossible by natural law, hence I conclude it must be supernatural. Evolution literature merely shows microevolution, or it's simply a description of comparative biology among species with their evolution simply asserted. Now I'm going to go through some examples of in the evolution literature from science journals, and I will critique them and show you what is claimed to be evidence for evolution really is not. For example, in the journal Bacteriology, it was claimed that the E. coli evolved into a new species. You read the abstract, and that's what the author says. All it did was show a change in E. coli. The author cultured E. coli over like 30,000 generations. And all it showed was a change from its ability to metabolize glucose to citrate, which is consistent with only one enzyme modification, no increase in complexity. Another example of microevolution, it was claimed that you can evolve a multicellular creature from a unicellular creature in the Journal of Nature Communications. And all they did was show that a particular type of algae grew thicker cell wall, causing it to clump. No true multicellularity because all the cells were the same, no division of labor. Another example of microevolution, this classic paper by Dobzhansky, he claimed that you could evolve reproductive isolation in Drosophila, where he got 2 strains of one Drosophila fruit fly species were bred to become what he said were reproductively isolated. But the author admits, and he used the word ethological, which means behavioral. The reproductive isolation was purely behavioral and not physiologic. Another claim was that the multi-protein flagellum evolved. This is a different type of paper, and it's simply a description of the comparative biology in nature with no evolution demonstrated. And all the author did was he compared the flagellum protein numbers and their DNA sequences among various species. So it was a single generation survey of many species with the evolution simply asserted. No evolution demonstrated. Similarly, another paper, Journal of Bacteriology, claimed that the bacteria could evolve a multi-step enzymatic pathway to degrade 2,4-dinitrotoluene, which is a man-made pollutant. And all the author did was compare enzymes of a strain that was able to degrade 2,4-DNT to another strain which had a similar pathway that had a different function. But he didn't show that one came from the other. Both strains were living at the same time. It was a single-generation survey of 2 different strains. No evolution demonstrated. It was simply asserted. Another comparative biology description, no evolution, is a pseudogene study. Bernie talked about the Gulo gene. Well, the Gulo gene is the gene that helps in vitamin C production. Humans can't make vitamin C, so it's believed that, but lesser animals can. When you go to the original reference, all the authors showed what it was a survey of data banks. There's DNA input into a data bank, and the authors looked to see, did a computer test to see where the DNA matched up. And all it was that the actual functioning gene compared to the human gene had some mutations, were different by a few mutations, but all the human gene has was 5 out of the 12 exons of the functioning gene. In other words, those small mutations Bernie mentioned were only small mutations in 5/12 of the gene, not the entire gene. 7 out of the 12 exons, which are segments of the gene, weren't even present at all. Now, the other thing is the assertion by evolutionists is since this gene has no other function, it therefore, by default, must be signs of evolution. Well, that's not true. And I listed there in the Annual Review of Genetics in the Journal of Science, authors have shown that pseudogenes are important in gene regulation. But the sheer logic of since we don't know why something is there, then it must be evolution, is not good scientific thought. So evolution arguments are distorted. It involves tests without really observing or implementing the theory, inferring without examples, and there's a conflation between microevolution and macro. The big elephant in the room with the theory of evolution is that its studies are ignored. Is evolution is simply ignored in many studies as a dynamic, multi-generational theory involving random mutation, natural selection, and instead, the studies look at static single generations and they don't show any random mutation or natural selection. And it results in studies simply showing a series of outcomes, whether it be fossils or pseudogenes, with the evolution simply asserted. Now, what would real evidence for evolution be? Well, if you showed one species evolving into a physiologically different species by random mutation natural selection. Well, some would argue, well, that would take millions of years. And I would counter-argue, well, therefore it's not testable and not a science. So why creationism? Human documentation is a conventionally accepted for historical truth. You can infer it, increased complexity correlates with increased intelligence better than evolution does. Biochemical interactions are statistically impossible by evolution, and there's no evidence that complexity and physiologic reproductive isolation can be created by natural law. Therefore, supernatural. That's all.
Thank you, Dr. Rask. You'll now have 10 minutes in which you can interrogate Mr. Dehler. You're free to converse, but Mr. Rask will be able to interrupt you.
Just a note on this, too. He's going to ask a question, and I'm going to reply. And if I'm not answering it right, he has the right to interrupt me and say that's not what I'm asking for. So it's not being rude to interrupt here. It's just more of he's in the driver's seat, and then we're going to switch it, and I'll be in the driver's seat.
I'm going to preface this question. We know that scales are confirmed to measure weight by calibrating against objects of known mass. We know that an ultrasound is confirmed to measure fetal age by calibrating with the age confirmed by parental history. We know that the time of death in humans, as measured by temperature and rigor mortis, is calibrated by the gold standard of human witnesses. Yet you claim that pseudogenes in fossils are a measure of evolutionary relationships. What is the gold standard that you use to calibrate pseudogenes and fossils as indicating evolution?
Okay, so with pseudogenes especially, it's not a matter of a gold standard, it's a matter of logic. Back to the criteria of adequacy, you have two hypotheses, which one makes more sense? And pseudogenes is a fact of the world, whether you think they're pseudogenes or not, but DNA is a fact, and so what can you learn from the DNA? Well, it looks like the pseudogenes perfectly align with evolutionary theory and make no sense whatsoever from a creationist viewpoint.
How do you know, what is the empirical evidence, what is the evidence that evolution theory can produce pseudogenes?
Okay, evolutionary theory does not produce pseudogenes. Pseudogenes is evidence for evolutionary theory.
And what empiric evidence is there that pseudogenes are evidence of evolution theory? How do we know? How do we know evolution theory exists to produce pseudogenes?
Well, so basically, I would say the situation is that we have pseudogenes, which I showed on the chart there, where we have, according to evolutionary theory, there's these ancestors, and there's certain offspring from those, like the gorilla and the chimp and the human. And when you look at the pseudogenes, it aligns with descent. In no case does a chimp have the same pseudogene as a gorilla, but not the human, for example, or something like that, because the way it flows downhill, I showed where there's one where they all shared it, and then the next one there's three where they all shared it except for the gorilla, and then there's another
three.
So
what you're saying is that the visually closer a creature looks, the closer their pseudogenes look.
Well, yeah, so basically I think according to the fossil record, they created a tree of life, so to speak, what they think that the ancestral relationships are. And from what I understand, in some cases DNA switched some of that around because the DNA is more accurate information.
And what about the alternative hypothesis is that their pseudogenes are more similar between man and chimp versus man and mouse because genotype correlates with phenotype. Isn't that a simpler, that it involves fewer assumptions?
No, not at all, because the graph I had on there was not about mice. It was about hominids like the chimp, the gorilla, the human.
Well, no, my question still holds. Wouldn't you agree that pseudogenes are closer among closer appearing creatures, are more similar among closer appearing creatures, which is why you think that chimps are closer evolutionary to man than a mouse?
Okay, but the thing with pseudogenes are, the chart that I gave, they're for the olfactory sense, which is your sense of smelling, and they're called pseudogenes because we lost that sense. So these are all busted genes, and these busted genes, the more, according to descent, the more of them get busted. And so you can say, well, maybe they'll find a function for these genes, but it looks like
they actually have found a function.
For some of them, but not, I mean,
so most
of them.
So what you're saying is that since we don't know their function, they must be a result of evolution. Is that what you're saying?
No, what I'm saying is they have a known function. And according to evolution, there's a certain ancestral, lineup. And when we look at those ancestors, we can actually see these genes working as intended. And we have chopped up versions of them, so they don't work. So it's obvious. The alternate hypothesis is God just made things from scratch with busted copies. Or why would he make some function that looked like it was from some other function that actually had a job to do?
Well, there's only four nucleotides, so it's bound statistically that there's going to be stretches of nucleotides that are similar among similar species, because there's only four. Now, the way I interpret pseudogenes, well, first of all, we have found functions for some of them in gene regulation. When authors say that these genes don't work, what they mean is they don't produce a protein. But there are other genes that have functions in regulating adjacent proteins, such as in when the protein gene adjacent to it turns on and off, and how frequently it does, and whether it operates in that particular tissue. So these genes, although they don't produce proteins, they do have functions found in most of them. Now, it is not evolution. If it's a real science, you can't have it be a science by default. Bernie is saying that since we don't know their function, they must be busted up from evolution. But do you understand what I'm getting at is we don't see the evolution producing these.
Well,
what is wrong with my concern?
Okay, there's two things. Like I said, if you look at the ancestral species, according to evolution, these genes actually do a function, for example, the olfactory sense. They actually have keener smelling. We have a mutated copy of that. Now you say, well, there's some other function that was discovered for that. Dennis Venema is a Christian who is an evangelical Christian who tries to tell his fellow Christians the evidence for evolution. And he says, arguing that they found some function for a busted gene is like saying, let's say there's a beautiful castle somewhere, and it got bombed out during World War II. And somebody could say, like, well, that used to be a castle, obviously. And somebody else might, just because, so that used to be a castle, so that's kind of like a pseudogene. It's something busted that used to exist. And somebody else might say, like, no, that was created that way. Well, why would somebody create a busted castle? Well, there's function for it, because there's birds that use that for nests. It's a sanctuary for a certain kind of bird.
Let me interrupt. You say that these are busted genes. I assert that the genes that you don't know, that bust, saying that genes are busted is using a term that goes along with your theory. You say they're busted. I just say they're different, but look, have some similarities.
Well, the other thing is, you said that...
Just because something has similarities... My problem is that just because there's similarities among DNA and among physical characteristics, you imply that as prima facie evidence that the fact that there must be a common ancestor. All they did, these detective pseudogenes, is they looked in a database and found some similarities among five twelfths of the gene. Now, there's nothing that says that one gene came from, that a functional a functionless gene was derived from a functional. No one's ever seen it happen. Now, you assert that happened. My problem is there's no empiric evidence that the busted, what you call a busted gene, which is what I call a different gene, was derived by the process of random mutation and natural selection. Is there any empiric evidence that a functioning gene in one creature by random mutation, natural selection over generations produces what you call a busted gene? Has anyone ever documented that to occur?
Okay, well, that's what I'm saying is, I think we have two choices here. One choice is that this Gulo gene, that it looks like it's a Gulo gene in the human being, but it doesn't work. You're saying that God made us from scratch, and he had some kind of feature he made from DNA code that just happened to look really similar to the Gulo gene, but it has some other function.
That's right.
And the evolutionary viewpoint is that this Gulo gene really worked and had a function, and now it doesn't. And now we see the remnants of it. Now you said too that the DNA code, there's only four letters. Of course you're going to see similarities, but actually just the opposite. There is a lot of redundancy in there. Like, for example, there's an amino acid called leucine, and there's at least six different combinations. There's a lot of redundancy. There's like six different combinations. Like, for example, I don't know what it is, but like, let's say it's ATG. It could go ATA, and there's no effect whatsoever. There's no change because it's the same exact amino acid. So there's like, just for leucine alone, there's like, that's one of the most popular ones, I think, that has the most redundancy. But there's more than one way to code an amino acid. So you can change a letter, and it's the same exact amino acid. And even if you do change the amino acid, like in insulin across humans and chimps, there's actually amino acid change, but they both work. So you can even change an amino acid within a protein, and it still works. So there's a lot more flexibility. It's not like you change one letter and boom, everything dies, and it's very hard to code this thing.
Okay, thank you.
Bernie, you now have 10 minutes to interrogate Dr. Rask.
Okay, can I have the screen projection again? Okay, so you said over and over again there's no evidence for evolution, right?
Yes.
So I want to review two major things that strike me as the evidence. I briefly talked about this, and one we talked about a little bit is the pseudogene. And if we have time, we'll talk some more about this. But I want to go to this fused human chromosome number 2. So just as a summarize, are you familiar with this argument, basically? Okay, so basically, on the left here, you see two chromosomes in the chimp. And on the end, there's what they call telomeres. It's an ending sequence to show that's the end of that chromosome. And in the center, there's a centromere. Now, we have one less set of chromosomes than other hominids, like, and even the Denisovans and Neanderthals. Neanderthals are not considered human there in Europe, and Denisovans are Asian hominids that are extinct. So why do we have one less chromosome? It was, you know, that might be a mystery. But here we see our fused human number, our number 2 chromosome looks like fused. You can see those two, it looks like those two came together. So in the middle there, we have two telomeres, and we don't need telomeres. Those are vestigial. They're not used as telomeres. So in our chromosome number two, we have vestigial central telomeres in the middle, and we have one of our centromeres activated, because you only need one centromere. The other one is a vestigial centromere. So is it, my question to you, isn't it obvious that human chromosome two has vestigial centromeres and telomeres?
When you say vestigial, I mean they have no known function.
No, I mean, vestigial looks like it's a left. I mean, how else would you explain this?
I explain it with the exact amount of evidence that you have. I say it was derived by creationism, and I have no empiric evidence. Now, you forget there's problems with your theory. Number one, it has never been documented that a creature can evolve into another creature with a fused chromosome and become reproductively isolated and viable and be reproductively fertile to create another creature.
So what if I agree with you? We don't know how it happened, but we have evidence here that it did happen without knowing
it's not,
how it
well,
happened.
You're saying that it did happen, meaning it was derived by evolution. Okay. No, all you're showing is two chromosomes that have some similarity to it. You don't show that they were derived by random mutation, natural selection,
well,
and derived into. Now let me digress.
Well, let me first give one more piece of evidence I didn't mention.
Okay.
When you look at the code, the DNA code on the left one, there's those two genes. There's certain bands on what that code is in there, and when you match and when you look at that on our fused chromosome, the code matches up almost identical.
Well, I question that. What it is, chromosome banding patterns can be misleading. There was a study, and I'm looking at my notes to get it accurate. It was believed that the human Y chromosome was only 1.9% different than the chimp Y chromosome. And that when the chromosomes were compared to each other, the chromosome banding pattern looked identical. The sequencing showed a 1.9% difference. That's not a lot. However, that 1.9% difference is not a reflection of the orientation of the gene. What they did is they determined, I looked up the original references by the chimpanzee-human consortium, published in the Journal of Nature. You don't have to believe anything I say. You can look it up for yourself. When they actually sequenced the gene, now the original way that
you need to summarize, because I want to go to more questions here.
Okay.
So just for like 20
my point
seconds.
Is, when they actually sequenced the gene in order, the Y chromosome, which was thought to be a 1.9% difference, actually turned out to be a 30% difference.
Okay, but that's off topic, though. I'm talking about this fused human chromosome.
Well, what I'm saying is your chromosome banding pattern doesn't reflect its actual DNA sequence.
Okay.
That's my point.
My other point
is no one has ever seen fused chromosomes as a progeny in a different species.
Okay, I would just say that's incredible, because I think the DNA, I mean, that this DNA matches across these two chromosomes is like indisputable, I would think.
The banding pattern matches, but not the but we don't know, it hasn't been, I don't know if number two has been sequenced
sure.
yet.
Yeah, all the genomes have been
They've
sequenced,
They've been sequenced in terms of what the DNA consists of, but not in terms of their orientation on the, only as far as of 2010, they've only sequenced the Y and the, they've only determined the orientation of the gene pattern on the Y chromosome and chromosome number 22.
What do you mean the orientation of it?
How the genes are oriented in terms of one is on the left side, position number 12 and so forth, how it's oriented.
Well, that's part of the code, the DNA code.
Well, the DNA code is part of, the sequencing that determines that it's...
They have to know exact location of where the base pairs are.
Base pairs of fragments. It's a fragment. It's what they use, the shotgun technique. They take fragments of it, and these fragments match, but they don't know the exact orientation.
Okay.
For many of them, they don't know the exact orientation.
Well, I would disagree with that from my understanding. I would refer
people... But regardless of that, you claim that this was a result of evolution, but no one's ever seen this phenomenon occur.
Well, okay, so...
I say it's from creationism, and how is your evidence better than mine?
I just want to say, by the way, I'd refer people to... There's a YouTube with Kenneth Miller who goes over in detail about this fused human chromosome number two, and I think this is kind of overwhelming evidence. So your explanation here is that... Well, you acknowledge that the centromere in the human one lines up with the centromere in one of the chimp ones?
I acknowledge that there's a lot of similarities, yes.
And they actually happen to line up in the other centromere. It looks like a centromere code that's not working as a centromere.
Okay. They look very similar. I agree.
Okay. So your idea is that God made this right one from scratch.
Yes.
And even though it looks like in the middle there's telomeres, yes, that they're not really telomeres. There's some kind of unknown function yet to be discovered.
That's right. That's science, is
okay,
finding things that are unknown.
Yeah, so to me, that just strikes me as very unreasonable. But
well, what makes your theory reasonable? Are there any examples?
Well, I mean, right there is an example. They line up perfectly.
Hold on, Bernie. Remember, this is one of my points. Evolution is a dynamic theory. You're claiming that one was derived from another. All you're showing is that they exist at the same time. Evolution is a dynamic theory saying that the right was a result of random mutation and natural selection of the left. There's no demonstration of your random mutation. I'm calling you out. This is that last slide, the big elephant in the room. The big elephant in the room is he's showing an outcome, yet he's not showing how that outcome was derived. He's just asserting it was derived by evolution.
I'm showing the facts that we have to deal with, and then you say which hypothesis makes best sense of the facts.
But you're claiming evolution is a science. It must be testable and supportable by empirical evidence.
It's supportable by evidence, and this is a piece of evidence. Okay,
the evidence of evolution.
I want to go on to the next. I want to go on to the other one. This is the pseudogenes. Okay, so like number one, okay, the first pseudogene, this is for the olfactory sense or sense of smelling. At the very bottom there, you see number one, okay? That's a common ancestor to all of these hominids, a human, chimp, gorilla, and orangutan. All of them have this, it looks like a busted gene because this gene works in other ancestors, but not in any of these. They all have that. Everybody underneath that has that one. Now the next one is a three. That common ancestor, the gorilla, the chimp, and the human all have that, but not the orangutan. And see the 11 busted genes that the orangutan has? The gorilla doesn't have those, the chimp doesn't have those, the human doesn't have these. This looks like it's all obvious from descent. Now, this, I don't know how you can explain this from creationism. How you're saying that God would make a gorilla and a chimp, boom, gorilla, boom, chimp. There's no biological relationship between these two, but yet they both have this messed up code of, or this unknown code for some reason. There's three of them, which happens to work in their ancestor, but not them.
Well,
but it's made for some other reason.
You call a busted gene, I just call a gene that has some similarities with another gene.
Gene just happened to look like a gene that actually functions in an ancestor, but doesn't in them.
Well, it there's only four nucleotides, so there's bound to be some crossover among DNA nucleotide patterns among species for different functions.
Let me see if I have a slide about this. You keep on talking about this.
No, I know about the redundancy.
This is an example here. Like this is an insulin code, and so for example, see on the bottom one where it says DS. These are all the top one is a human HS. PT is a chimp. The DS are different configurations that you could have. So for example, the fourth one over to the right, to the left of the green, it's called leucine. That's an amino acid. Okay, it's CTG for human, CTT for chimp, but it could be CTG, CTA, CTC, CTT, TTA, TTG. It could be any of those, and it's still exactly leucine, no change whatsoever. So when you say there's only four codes, these are the amount of possibles are actually tremendous. There's a huge playground. Okay.
So now we'll open it up to questions from the audience. And we'd really like these to be sort of conversation-based. So you're allowed to speak multiple times. You can speak to both speakers, that sort of thing. And if you're making progress on the issue, I won't interrupt you. But if things keep rambling on, we'll move on.
If you want to come up here, you can be on camera. And I'll give you a free copy of my booklet signed.
You don't have to.
I'll sit right here.
Okay.
My question would be, is there testable evidence within the ancient bones found of Denisovan, Neanderthal, that are they able to extract accurate DNA to relate to humans? From what I read, that there's percentages that they've recently found the first evidence of Denisovans in Siberia, which was found in Neanderthal from Western Europe, mixed into African humans, into the rest of the world. It's, you know, it's spread across with different percentages. I don't know how accurate that is. I don't know if it's actually testable.
Let me comment on that. I'm an orthopedic surgeon. Dead bones don't contain DNA. Soon after a body dies and undergoes decay, the cells within the bone undergo what's called apoptosis. That means they burst. And whatever in there leaks out and is eaten by bacteria. And I read these studies where they analyze the DNA from bones, and I laugh at them because their bones are found in dirt, which have been munched on and crapped on by everything over it, and they claim that the DNA was from the fossil. It's absurd. You're finding a fossil in dirt, and then you claim that the DNA found on it came from the bone. It's absurd.
Sure, yeah, I didn't know.
Yeah. Okay, well, I just think, like,
I've read those studies. Okay. They're really silly. You put that in a medical journal, and they'll laugh at you. But it's accept. This is why I call evolution a pseudoscience. They accept this sloppy test because that's all they have.
Okay. I just think, like, a quick comment that papers like this, they are peer-reviewed by other experts in science. Bart said his book, for example, is peer-reviewed, but it's equivocation. It's a different use of terms. In Bart's way, he wanted to publish a book, and he got some comments from people that had an opposing opinion, and he put those in his book. He calls that peer-reviewed. The way science does peer review is you submit an article, and they could reject it, or they'll say this is not good enough. So that's not the same kind of peer-reviewed. As far as I understand this, Denisovan DNA and Neanderthal DNA and their studies, this is all peer-reviewed. I think it's trustworthy.
Okay, let's move on. Okay.
Right here? I want to thank you, gentlemen, for presenting today. And I want to start off with saying that I'm a medical doctor also, and I'm a creationist. I believe in God, and there's many reasons for that. To start with, I mean, I don't care whether evolution is right or wrong in my perspective. I think even if we have evidence that we have similar genes as a chimpanzee or a monkey or whatever, that does not tell that God did not create us. That he created us and he created the chimpanzees. He can, if we agree that there is a creation in the first place, we can say that the one who created certain creation, he can borrow some DNA, whatever he wants, to create another being. That's the first thing. Another thing, you mentioned, Mr. Bernie, that if we don't know a certain thing, that does not mean it is magic. So if we hear an earthquake or thunder, it does not mean that it's magic. I agree with you 100%. But if we find something that is complex, it is only reasonable to say that a complex being created that. So if we're, in a desert or in whatever, in the forest, and we hear music, we can say that this music is being produced by a musician or by a radio, whatever. We cannot explain it, but we have to say that it is a creation, somebody created it, somebody with intelligence. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to say that because I think we all agree that Big Bang happened 13.7 billion years ago. And after that...
Not necessarily. I don't think everybody agrees with that.
Okay, a lot of us agree. Okay. Me and you, at least, right?
Okay.
You could get to your question.
We have other people wanting to ask.
Yeah, so this is the question, actually. We agreed that it happened very long time ago. And after that, there was a lot of heat. The life wasn't able to happen. My question is, how would the first cell, very complex being, very, very complex being, came about?
Yeah.
Give me any theory. I mean, even if you cannot support it, any theory.
Well, I would just say that that's what scientists are trying to discover right now. They don't really have it all worked out. Yeah, right. Just like the Neanderthals didn't have it worked out why lightning or thunder works or earthquakes.
Yeah, but thunder works and earthquakes is not a very complex thing. We can say
it is not to us because of our knowledge now, but it was complex than Neanderthals.
No. So the thunder and there's not complex things. It's just a sound, right? It's just a noise.
Yeah, right? But what caused it?
Yeah, they can say we don't know, right? Mm-hmm. They don't know the reason. But
well, it must be the gods, right? But I just wanted to mention, you mentioned the reason why evolution is such a huge deal with Christian theology is because they believe in an Adam and Eve that we all descended from, it, that they're the first humans. And the thing is, with evolution, there's no first of any species, because evolution happens over time and within a population. Never does the first human pop out of a non-human. There's no such thing as a first fish, first rabbit, first human, first anything. So that's a big complication. This is one reason why I say it's a watershed event, because once you accept this, then I think it enables everything about evolution to be
Let's
known.
Go to the next question. Please.
Well, maybe Bart can reply on this too. I'd be able to give
I
him
have
a chance.
I have nothing to add. Go ahead.
I just want to mention one thing too, because of all the things you said, is that you said if you go and hear music in the forest, then we know there's an intelligence behind that. Well, that's because of our experience.
Actually, I do have something to add. There's this often a confusion of explaining how things work versus how they originated. Bernie cites several examples of how thunder works and how X works and how Y works, but the issue is not how it works. Scientists are finding out how things work all the time. The issue is historical. How did it begin? And there is no known science to go back that far. All the science, we do have science that can go back in time in terms of, like, we can determine how long ago somebody died. We can determine the age of a tree. There are limitations on historical information. And that they're all based on human observation as the gold standard. In evolution, there is no gold standard on which to base any of their measurements. Okay, that's all.
I think we've come full circle here, so let's go. Right there, yeah.
Okay. I have a question. I wanted to push back against something that, Bernie, that you said. Could you go to the slide, actually, with where you were showing the orangutans and then the gorillas and all the...
The pseudogenes?
Yeah, the pseudogenes. So, looking down the line, you see all these different species, and then today you see orangutans, gorillas, chimps, and humans, and you see all these similarities, right? Mm-hmm. And it's easy, so... I just want to make sure I understand. You're saying retroactively that seems to assume that they are related. Yes, sir. Correct?
I'm saying this is what we're seeing in the DNA. And it
okay, so they're related then. Historically from evolution is what you're suggesting, right?
They're related.
The tree of life that we have these
species
originate from common descent.
I'm saying one fact is that there's actual genes at work, and these are all pseudogenes. All of these genes are busted genes.
Right, and I'm asking, right. Just so we're clear for my mm-hmm. question, mm-hmm. that is evidence for common descent.
Right.
Okay. So, given today that we see these similarities, we're talking about creationism, right? Mm-hmm. So creationism obviously implies creativity. A great example that leads straight into my question is like, I like to do pottery, and it's a very creative thing. You make a lot of different things. Almost all my pottery looks the same. How is that? How do you square the fact that these look the same with being evidence of this grandiose theory when, at the same time, if I make pottery all the same, it doesn't mean that one flew up. I understand that it's not a perfect analogy.
No. I could work with your analogy.
If there was a creator,
right.
Then you would absolutely expect them to look incredibly similar, and there's evidence for that all over. Potter is one of them.
I can work with your illustration. So, to make this fit your illustration, you have a bunch of pots you make, okay, and there's another pot over here with broken handles and things. They look like broken handles, and you had another pot over here that had 10 handles, let's say. And this one's got 2 handles. Looks like they got busted handles, and somebody says, "Oh, that pot was made." Unique by maybe some other person. And somebody else would say, like, no, it looks like it was made by the same person. In fact, it looks like the same pot, but maybe they dropped it because you can see all these remnants and everything. That's what we're looking at. We're not looking at creative designs. We're looking at busted things that are inherited. So it's like you're making brand new pots with busted things in it. And why do your busted things resemble these things that actually work in other pots?
Because I'm making multiple pots.
You don't purposely put in broken things in your pot. You don't put in broken handles and things like that.
Let me add something to that.
Use the code that Intel puts in to find out when people are copying them. Use the plagiarism example in books and Intel code. It'll answer his question. You know, when you inherit errors from the same source, it's the same error. They either got two errors that were identical put in there, or somebody copied someone. These are like plagiarism from errors that have been inherited from books or Intel. That's why Intel puts code that it has error in it in their chips, so they can find out if someone copies it. These are errors that the human has all of them, except they don't have 4, 11, and 5. The chimp has all of them except for 15.
Well, I have a comment about that. First of all, we don't know that they're errors. You assume that they're broken, but they're just different.
The Gulo gene is one of four in a series that produces vitamin C. It has the same point mutation, and there's many, many different mutations in there that you can tell between the different.
It has several point mutations in 5/12 of the gene. The other thing, so what you're doing is you're assuming that similarity equals common descent. You're redefining what the criteria for common descent. Common descent is not defining. The defining feature of common descent is not whether you parse out the similarities of certain genes. Common descent is defined by the ability of your parents to reproduce. You and your cousins are common descent from your grandparents because you know your grandparents reproduced. The problem with this is twofold. Number one, you're assuming that these differences are, one is a broken version of the other, whereas it's simply different. That's a presumption. You're presuming it based on you can believe that, but it's not scientifically supported, because it also, to believe that means you must believe that an ancestral primate was able to evolve into two different populations that cannot mate. That phenomenon has never been documented. So number one, you're assuming
20,000 pseudogenes, and there's 200,000 ERVs that are shared between chimps and humans.
ERVs.
You can't randomly insert it. You can't. It's perverse to say that they're not. They don't share the same antibodies. Also, what has not come out yet is these pseudogenes are not just shared between the two species, but they're in the same location on the chromosomes. And since they sit there for a while, they develop some of the same mutations. And you can nest these in terms of the mutations that have been built up. For example, the enamel gene in placental mammals that produces enamel in teeth. You can look at placental mammals and find the enamel gene that's broken in the aardvark and baleen whales. You have to posit that some strange god wanted to put that in there just to fool us. We have In embryology in humans, we make a yolk sac, but there's no yolk in it. But we have the yolk gene on a chromosome, and it's in the same location as chickens. Why would God do that unless it looks like we evolved from a common ancestor?
Let's move on, please. To the guy in the back.
I got a question kind of directed toward Dr. Rask. You said that there are no, there's no visual examples of an animal turning into another animal. Are you familiar with ring species?
Yes.
How would you account for those?
They are behaviorally reproductively isolated. They fall into two categories. Some are behaviorally, and some are just comparisons of species at the same time. Oftentimes, ring species are just a survey of species living at the same time, and they're just showing that there's some similarities and differences among them. It doesn't show that one ring species evolved from another. So it's my comparative biology study. It's a survey of creatures, comparing and contrasting them. It's a single generation study used to support a multi-generation theory. So what that falls into that category. The other category is the other ring species. The ones that do follow the multi-generation are only behaviorally reproductively isolated. You go back, you don't have to believe it, you go back and read the literature. You'll either see all it is a comparison of different species living at the same time, no evolution shown, or they show that they are reproductively isolated, but no one ever tests if they could mate. They only tested that they only show that they do not mate. Those are the two. If you don't believe me, look it up yourself. I've surveyed 400 of these articles, and those are the two, that's what they fall into.
Just a short comment. By the way, what a ring species is, like, for example, a couple examples would be seagulls and salamanders, that there's alive today let's say, seagulls that are at different locations, and the ones that are nearest each other can all mate with each other, but by the time you get to the end points, I don't know if they circle around or not, but by the time you get to the end points, they cannot mate anymore because of all the changes.
They've taken ring species at opposite ends and successfully gotten them to breed before? Or how are you justifying, how are you saying that these ring species can interbreed even though we have no evidence that they can't?
No, what I'm saying is no one has showed that they're physically, I'm not saying what they can't, I'm saying evolutionists make assertions. Those assertions have to be backed up by evidence. If you want to assert that ring species are different, then you have to show that they simply cannot reproduce. That has not been shown. I haven't shown the other. I can't claim that they showed that they were physiologically reproductively isolated. I'm saying the papers that I've read, they did not confirm that they were physiologically reproductively isolated. All they showed, well, they can, yeah, they're not, I agree, they can mate in some, what's that?
It's a type of ring species.
And what's the point? I'm not understanding.
They cannot successfully make offspring.
So, what's the point?
You're saying that the only reason that this is not evolution is because because of their habits, they choose not to mate. Not because they can't.
What I'm saying is that if evolution were true, it has to explain the observed phenomenon that there are species that simply cannot mate. Now, I agree that a mule is an example of microevolution. Mule goes into the microevolution category. It's a different species, but it can mate. And some mules are it's a product of two species that can mate.
Let's move on to the back corner over there.
Oh, well, by the way, we need to be out of this room at 9 o'clock, and it's getting near, and so this might be the last question.
Okay. Do you want to?
Yeah, question for the creationist guy. So,
I know who I am.
I was wondering, in your PowerPoint, you stated that since we have historical records that support creationist theories, that
yes.
That's the point in favor of creationism over evolution.
I'm sorry, what was that again?
PowerPoint, you stated that since we have historical records that support creationist theories, that's a point for creationism over evolution. What I was wondering, though, is there are a lot of creation stories. Like, we have, like, tons of Native American tribes that have their own creation stories. We have creation stories, Buddhism, Hinduism, Christianity. And, you know, obviously it makes the logical sense that all of these could be true at the same time. So I was wondering, what makes your creation story more credible than any of the others for which we also have many historical records?
Well, I don't have a good answer for that. I don't know about the other creation stories. And this is my first point about historical documentation. It's a he said, she said. You can either believe some historical documents or you can't. And I don't have a way of arguing one way or the other. I choose to believe that, but there's no point in arguing about this because it's written documentation and you can either believe it or not. Some people believe the Holocaust, some people don't. Some people dispute over the date of the George Washington's birth. It's historical documentation. You can either believe that the people wrote it down, knew what they were talking about, or not. That's all I can say about that. There's not much more to say.
The Big Bang works with that, though. Christian creation story is the only creation event, at least as I'm aware, that asserts that time and space came into being.
Well, I don't think history is a matter of just believing it or not. I mean, I think history is based on evidence. So I just
sometimes
agree
the only
you.
Evidence you have is what people wrote down.
Yeah, but that's evidence that you weigh.
That goes along with her point. Okay. Which evidence that might conflict with each other is better, and I don't have a good answer for that.
We can continue the discussion outside, but we're going to have to start packing up now.
I'm not either one of you guys.
Well, wait, hold on. We got just 1 minute summary here too before we leave, and I want to let you know too. I'm gonna be here probably hanging out till like 10 o'clock. So if you want to talk to me afterwards, we can do that. So, who
will leave
first?
I'll go. So, a feature of natural sciences is learning what the limits are. You can't have a perpetual motion machine, and melting lead will not turn into gold. My view of evolution is it disregards the observed limits of nature by rationalizing that its limits are greater than observed because of the billions of years necessary. And to me, that this billions of millions of years is equivalent to my supernatural. It cannot be tested. And my impression is that since many begin with the premise that there is no supernatural, the atheist tends to over-rationalize evolution to make it superficially appear as a natural phenomenon, like trying to get a square peg into a round hole. But when you critically look at the science and remember what evolution's mechanism involves, random mutation, natural selection, and what it needs to accomplish, you find that the evidence really isn't there and it looks like it's impossible. One must accept that the real science to conclude that the creation of life, because of that, you have to conclude that the creation of life could not have been by natural law. In the past, many have falsely attributed questions about how life functions to the supernatural. So with the advent of the scientific method, we know that life is not governed by supernatural, but by natural laws. The problem is that since many assume that since man erred on life's functions, it also must err on its origin. But to show this, unfortunately, science had to deviate from scientific methodology to try to show the results that they want. That's my conclusion.
Okay, and just summary, one thing I want to mention, this is something John brought up too about the copy errors. So basically, Bart says that it is not testable. It's not science because it's not testable. And it is testable in the sense that you can look at the evidence and see which hypothesis makes the best sense of the world. Now, like John was mentioning about the microcode, it turns out in computer chips, just one example, it turns out in computer chips there's a microcode in there. And that controls a lot of the functions of the chip. There's a competitor of one major manufacturer one time that was accused of copying this other chip. And one way they know that there was copying going on is because the major manufacturer actually had accidents, bad code in there. And the person who copied it didn't know what they were doing, so they actually copied the bad stuff too. So not only is when you have the bad stuff, evidence that you copied something, the other piece of evidence is that they could have wrote the code in a different way, and that's actually what they had to do. They had to go to what they call a clean room and do it from scratch. And when they do it from scratch, of course, the code is totally different. I mentioned this one time to an evangelical Christian that's also an evolutionist, and he said, yeah, you know, maybe even a better example for Christians is the Bible. There is no original manuscript. They have manuscripts all over, different languages, different times, and they have criteria where they look at it. You can look at the copies. You can kind of figure out which one's older, which one's more reliable based on all kinds of, there's like a dissent within manuscripts. And so this logic is something you know very much about. So it's just applied to biology and not just the Bible, okay? You can, you know, apply it that way, so.
Let's proceed outside, folks.